Well, good morning, everybody, and thanks so much for joining us for Coffee and Real Estate Scoop with Stacy. We're very excited that we have our guest today, Maria Boyles, and she lives and operates her practice in Gainesville, Virginia, where she handles real estate and estate planning matters, and she has 6 years of experience. And in those areas, she's worked with various, those years she's worked with various roles, such as aspects of real estate, and she brings experience from processing transactions to handling settlements and managing a title company. So we're so excited that you started your new adventure here. We've known you from your previous adventure. So we're so excited and cheering for you as you just are launching your new business. So we're happy that you took the leap and are going out there on your own, and we'll try to support you when we can. So thanks so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much, Stacy. I really appreciate it. Yes, I'm super excited for this new venture. And like you said, I've had different roles in the past, and I'm really thrilled for this new one of being out on my own. As you know, being on your own opens things up to a really a new world, but you can do so much with it. And so I'm really excited about what it brings and the clients that I can work with. And I really appreciate all your support. And I'm really excited to chat with you this morning.
Okay, good. We're excited to have you. So so I want to start by just saying that there are a lot of attorneys out there. And I know that you do things in a special way that are different with so much care. And just a little bit about what sets you apart.
Yes, absolutely. And so I think that we can agree that some of the perception for attorneys, at least the feedback that I hear from folks, is that attorneys can come across as a little bit intimidating sometimes. And that's what I want to change. I want that to be different for my clients. I want to feel approachable. I want clients to feel open. They want to know that I'm open to answering questions. You know, there's no such thing as a silly question. We always say that. And so just want to be open, approachable. You mentioned I have various experience, and some of what I do is work with title companies. And so when I work with title companies, I will prepare legal documents for them for their transactions. Mm-hmm. Of course, for your transactions, when you have a sale, there is sometimes a variety of legal documents that might need to be prepared, and title companies would have an in-house attorney prepare those, or they might work with an outside attorney. And that's where I would come in. Of course, you're going to have your deed in every transaction, and where I believe I bring a different perspective to that is that since I've been a processor, I've sat in a different role before, and I've gone to the clerk and recorded them. I've gone through the motions of actually things getting, you know, getting things on record, and it looks a little bit different from where I'm sitting. And so I think that makes me more approachable as an attorney. But I'm also, you mentioned, I'm really passionate about doing estate planning. And I think that really goes hand in hand with real estate. And I'll mention a couple of those things a little bit later. But again, I just think it's an area that's important for people to feel comfortable, because whether it comes from a simple will or doing a trust, you know, having a trusted attorney that you feel like you can discuss those matters with, I think it's just really important.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And we've referred our clients and actually come and talk to you about our own business. So we appreciate all that in the past too. So thank you. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering if today you could help explain some different types of title for buyers so mm-hmm. that our buyers either on the call today or watching this later when we post it for the public to see if they have questions. It's definitely a question that comes up, and people always call and say, what does this mean? So.
Absolutely. I would love to talk about that. And I am going to do my very best to be as brief as I can. This is a topic I'm really passionate about. And so I could probably talk for an hour, but I promise I won't do that. I will try to keep it a little bit surface level to kind of get folks an idea. But like I said, feel free, you know, they can reach out to me if they have further questions. But basically, title companies might approach this a little bit differently, but they will ask the client to make a decision one way or another about how they want to take title. How do they want that to be described in the deed, that basically, you know, so the deed gets recorded in the land records and is a public record of the ownership of their property. And so that has to have an indication then of what type of title they want to have. And so there's a couple of different ones. And what I hear, and it sounds like you're getting the same feedback, is that sometimes people are confused about the words. Sometimes it's confusing what they mean. And the part of the reason I'm so passionate about getting this out to folks is that it has an impact on how you hold title currently and how it impacts your ownership, but it will also have an impact on you down the line. So if you pass away, so I'll dive in here to some of the details and we can try to flesh that out a little bit. Mm-hmm. So the first type is really just a simple type of one person being your only owner. And so you don't really have any option there. You're just the one person that owns it. Some of the characteristics there is that you're obviously free to transfer your interests however that is needed. No one needs to join in. You're the only owner. The one thing I wanted to mention is that at the time that you pass away, then your interest will then, your when I say interest, I mean your ownership in the property. Your interest will then pass however your will is set up. So whatever your will describes for your property to be transferred is how that will go. And then if you don't have a will, then Virginia law will decide who gets that property. And so again, you know, a plug for getting your estate planning done is that your property will transfer in that way. The second way that I'll mention is what's called tenants in common. And so this can be where you have multiple people, you'll have at least two, so you can have 2 or 100 people, and their interest doesn't have to be equal. So you can have one person own, say, 60% of the property, and then the other person own 40. But their interest is almost like a piece of a pie. So if you have a pie, you split it 40-60, then each person can actually sell or give away whatever they want with that 40 or 60%. They can go ahead and sell that to another person, if you will. And so that is basically an independent interest that you have in the property. But most importantly, what I wanted to mention there is that the most important characteristic is that it at the point that one of the owners passes away. So say we just have two people, that's easier. Mm-hmm. So I own a property, say with my sister, and we own it as tenants in common. If I pass away, then it will go however my will is set up. So my will says everything goes to my husband. So then my ownership in that property, I have 40%. My 40% of that property will go to my husband, and then they will be considered tenants in common there together. Right. So that's something to keep in mind. Especially we see this with investors. We want people to know, if you're investing in a property, will your family get your share, or do you want your share to go to your partner, whoever you're doing the investment with? Mm-hmm. And that brings me to to another type, which is called joint tenants with the right of survivorship. This one is identified in the sense that when you have two or more people, they do have to have an equal share. So say, again, I own a property with my sister, we have to own it 50-50. And that then will determine, that language will determine, at the point that I pass away, my interest will go to my sister. Not because my will says that it will go to my sister, but because the deed identifies our ownership interest as being joint tenants.
Correct.
And again, this can come into play, like I said, when you have an investor and you go in and say, we're going to do this together. If I pass away, it needs to go to the other partner. And so that allows, you know, for a little bit of planning down the road. The last interest that I will share that has an impact is what's called tenants by the entirety. This one is unique in the sense that it can only be utilized by a married couple. And so I mentioned the example of my sister and I buying a piece of property together. We're not married to each other, obviously. And so we cannot hold that tenants by the entirety. And that's unique in the sense it can only be used by married couples, because it also brings an aspect of creditor protection. So imagine that my husband and I own a property together. I get a judgment against myself, but it's only against me. The judgment is not against my husband and I. And so the creditor cannot put a lien against our home that we own as tenants by the entirety, because it has a creditor protection. Now, of course, if it's against both of us, then that's up for grabs. There is, of course, exceptions to this rule, like IRS liens, and then there is a bankruptcy exception. I'm not going to dive into that, but just know that basically the tax man can get us no matter what we
right.
he can get a hold of us. And so that's just something to keep in mind. And that's probably the one that we see most often, you know, in our transactions, because mm-hmm. we often see married, you know, couples purchasing properties together. And then that also has the natural survivorship built into it. And so there's no matter what the will says, when you have the survivorship language, then it will pass based on the concept of survivorship that's identified in the deed. The only thing that I wanted to just touch on just briefly when we talk about ownership is just, you could also hold a property in your trust. So that's another option. Yeah, when I say to hold it in the trust, that the actual legal owner is the trustee. So we say that it's held in trust, but the trustee is the legal owner. And then however the trust document is actually set up will be how that will be governed. So whatever the indications are there, and however, you know, whoever the trustee is and whoever is going to be successor trustees. Something that we've seen in the past too, you know, is having an owner be a corporation. And when I say a corporation or a business entity, it could be, you know, anything from a limited liability company to a corporation or to a partnership. We don't see a lot of partnerships these days, but that's obviously an option also as to how, and then that's going to be governed, that's going to be held by however the documents that the business is set up.
Okay.
That's the long and short of it. I can go on forever about that one, but I do, like I said, I think it's important. And I mentioned just because you can imagine how things can come up. You can always change it. So I'll say that if, you know, you find that you bought a property, you know, you bought it, even you were engaged, your client mm-hmm. engaged, they bought the property. Now they're married. Let's get together. Let's set up a deed that has you as tenants by the entirety, because not only just because you've gotten married and you have this property, you don't have that creditor protection. You will have received it, however, you probably set it up as joint tenants. And so it can always be changed, but sometimes it's too late if you're ready to transfer the property, or, you know, if someone has passed away and you're in the thick of it. And we've seen that before too with estates and how that needs to be dealt with. So, like I said, it can feel like a lot of legal mumbo jumbo, but it does actually matter. And so hopefully this was a little bit helpful with a brief explanation.
Yes, no, we understand. One thing before I move on, I get this question a lot of times. What if I've been married since and my name is different? What happens?
That actually doesn't matter, as long as the your name and basically your legal name is reflected in, when you get married, it'll show in the land records. And right. So as long as there's a trace of your legal name, you don't have to get your name changed on your deed. What happens often that we'll see, before I got married, if I own property, you know, I had my maiden name. When I sign my deed, I will actually sign it with now my married name, but it will have an also known as clause. So the deed will reflect both names. And that way, if you think about it, a lot of times when we deal with these legal documents that get recorded, we want to be able to trace everything back. the land records in Virginia is organized by name. They're not organized by property, which might seem a little confusing. And so you just want all documents to tie into each other. And so imagine you don't want to sign a new deed with just your new married name, because it wouldn't tie back to your maiden name when you purchase the property. Right. But as long as they're both on there, not a problem. And I mean, I have people that just want to have their married name on there, and that's fine. You know, I'm happy to charge them a small fee to get that. Not necessary. That's a very good question, though.
Okay, good. Because I think people get upset and say, but I want to make sure that you know it's me. So, but
exactly. And I will say, you know, whatever your name is shown on the deed is what's going to show on your tax record. So maybe you get something in the mail, you know, for your personal property, this is not your personal property taxes, but for your assessment for your real estate taxes. And you think, oh my goodness, this doesn't have my married name on it. It's always going to have your name, however it is shown in that, the land records, however your deed is set up. So if that bothers you, then we can change it, but just know that it's not necessarily wrong.
Okay, perfect. Good. Thanks for clarifying. So one of the other questions we had for you is, once a contract has been signed, if either party changes their mind for any reason, what happens? What should we do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we see this sometimes. And the first thing I'll say, and you probably talk to your client about this too, and then I want to reiterate is when you're getting ready to sell and where you're getting ready to purchase a property, you know, when you sign that document, it is a legal binding obligation. And so you should know what you're getting yourself into. You should understand what you're signing. You should be comfortable with the process. You should be comfortable with what it says. And so if you're not comfortable with it, you know, have them, obviously they should be reaching out to you or reach out to someone like me with a question, because once they sign it, they are legally obligated to perform unless they can get out via some of these contingencies, which is what I'll talk about here. But be prepared to follow through with the contract. You know, it's something that I always tell people. I said, don't go into it expecting to have a way out, because if you change your mind just willy-nilly, then you could potentially be facing a lawsuit. So I'll just start out by saying, you know, be ready to actually follow through. But it's a good question, because there are a couple of contingencies that we see built into the contract. Now, every contract is going to be different, because every person, every transaction, every property is going to be unique. And so I'll mention some of the contingencies that we see most frequently, but not all of these will be in all contracts, because it might not necessarily apply. But I just wanted to touch on a couple just to give people an idea of what it looks like. So one of the ones that we often see is a home inspection contingency. And so what that does is that basically you hire a professional that goes in, takes a look at it top to bottom. And if it turns out that there's something that's materially different or something that you didn't expect, then you can negotiate that. And, you know, I know you guys have been on the opposite side and done, you know, I'm sure plenty of negotiations of back and forth. Sometimes you do allowances, but sometimes they're just, you can't come to an agreement, or you just find that, I don't know, there's a crack in the foundation and nobody wants to pay for it, and it is just not a project you want to take on. And that wasn't something that you had expected when you put in the offer. And so that's going to be your out. That's you changing your mind about the purchase. And so you can go forward with getting out of the contract in that sense. Another contingency that we see is an appraisal contingency. And so part of this is to protect your lender if you are going to be purchasing with a loan. So if you are borrowing money to purchase the property, the lender wants to make sure that should you for some reason not make the payments and they have to foreclose, they want to make sure that they have enough money into this property. And so they will do an appraisal. Again, a professional will be hired to go through documentation to make sure that that is actually worth what you're purchasing it for. Another contingency that we see a lot is the financing contingency. And again, this goes back to if you're buying with a loan. And if you have a loan, you will need to actually, or if you want a loan, you have to qualify for the loan. And sometimes you get the pre-approval, but getting a pre-approval is sometimes just an indication of this is what I can, what you could potentially borrow. It's not a final approval of you getting the loan. And so there's usually a timeline associated with this in the contract, but this is your out if you can't get a loan. You're not expected to purchase a property cash, you know, should you not be able to get that loan. One other another contingency is if you need to sell your home in order to purchase the property, or if your seller wants to buy a property in order to sell there. So one way or another, you don't want to be stuck having two houses or not having a home at all. And so again, this is another way that you have a out if that doesn't actually occur. Now, we see these in, you know, more in some markets than others, partly just because not all sellers are excited about waiting for their buyer to sell their home in order to actually be able to sell that house. Right. Again, we do see it sometimes. And the last one that I'll just mention, and of course, this is not all properties, but some properties have an HOA or a property association that is associated with that property. And you'll get a lot of documentation. It's very lengthy and wordy, but you'll want to take a look at it and make sure that you understand any of the regulations that the HOA has in place so that you know exactly what you're getting yourself into. And again, that can be your out if you find that that's not something that you're not comfortable with doing. Of course, HOAs have to be reasonable with the regulations, but I think the word reasonable when it comes to HOAs might be an interpretation question there. We don't have time for that, I guess.
Right.
So those are some of the things that we see most often that are ways to, you know, get out of the contract, if you will.
Right. Absolutely. Well, what are some other things that you think that people in this climate right now with COVID happening, et cetera, mm-hmm. just any tips or anything that we need to be, you know, prepared for?
I mean, I think the best thing that we can do is safeguard your family, but let's take steps to continue to stimulate our economy. I mean, we are all in this together, and I think that we're going to get through this as a community. And I think if we all take responsibility of protecting ourselves, if you're feeling sick, don't go out there. But I think that once we can take reasonable steps to get out there and start stimulating economy, I think we'll find that we can start getting back on track. And that goes for buying and selling homes. You know, I find the buzz on the street is very much that there's not enough inventory. And right. You're probably seeing that. And I think that you can take very reasonable steps to secure your home. And I see you guys do it. You do the virtual home open houses.
Right.
And those are wonderful ways to get your property out there. And I will say that, you know, in a market that has low inventory, I'm seeing houses go for much more than what maybe you were expecting.
Right.
My husband and I are just joking and say, this is our time to sell. Right there, you know, in our right? I know who to call. This is our time to sell. We're not there, you know, as a family, but if we were there and, you know, as a family ready to sell, when I said this is our time to sell, it's because the market is hot, hot, hot. So mm-hmm. I think we need to get through this crisis, if you will, together. But I think we need to keep going. That's the best thing that we can do.
Right.
Be safe. And that's why I like how you guys do the virtual open houses. I think that's a wonderful use of technology.
Yes. And this method,
Zoom
has been our new, you know, kind of best friend here, trying to communicate to our clients and past clients and really keep them educated on what's happening. So, but I know we might have a couple of questions. So if someone has a question for Maria.
Hey, Maria, I got a quick question. So
yeah, how are you?
Summary, I'm doing well. As you know, I do help small business owners a lot. Mm-hmm. what types of services can they come to you for? Whether it's, you know, they're just starting out or they've already started, is there anything that you do there or anybody you refer them to?
Yes, if there's anyone that has a new business, I can help them with the startup. We can get you set up with the SEC, get your documents prepared. As an attorney, I always like to have everything in writing. So, you know, you probably see, just like I do, a lot of limited liability companies. And so with that, we would want to set up an operating agreement. And so getting everything worked out, it works through, is something that I can help them with. And it's with technology, it's thankfully a pretty easy process that we can do. And so, or if people are just wondering what that looks like, you know, they can reach out to me with questions as well.
Okay, excellent. Another, so that you, absolutely what I see a lot of is people wanting to set up a limited liability company. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I have people that have done that and they want to promote themselves to a S corp or a C corp. Is that another service you can help with?
I do some of that. I would say that I'm more focused on the limited liability side of it. And part of that is with the corporation, some of the tax issues, not tax issues, but tax planning. And some of those I would say go to someone that is more specialized in the tax field. I think it's really important as attorneys to know our, not limitation, but know exactly how we can help, because we can't be good at everything. Someone who's a general practitioner and wants to do anything that comes in the door. They, you know, as attorneys, we say, if you're a master at everything, you're a master at nothing. And so I'll say, if you want to go to a corporation, I can try to make a connection depending on your area, but with the limited liability companies, I'm very happy to help.
We say the same thing in real estate, right? Somebody who's an expert in townhouses shouldn't try to sell warehouses, right?
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Right. So excellent. Thank you. So good to see you.
Yeah, great to see you too.
Are there any other questions? Okay, just wanted to make sure there weren't any other questions. So, well, I would like to tell people, Maria, how to reach you now that you have started your new venture and your company is Solid Rock Law, and your new email address is mboyles, mboyles at solidrocklaw.com, and your number is 571-243-2707. And I will also post all of this with the recording in a few minutes as soon as I can get it downloaded. But we just wanted to say thank you so much. It was so nice to be with you today and get your take on a couple of things as well as what's going on in the current market. And we look forward to working with you and wish you all the very, very best. And
thank you so much.
Your new company. We're so excited for you and congratulations.
Thank you both. Wonderful to see you.
You too. Okay. Have a great rest of the weekend.
You too. Bye-bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.